Welcome to Ushaw College, the great training college for priests in the north of England. It is situated 4 miles to the west of Durham City, and so closely associated with its patron, St. Cuthbert. The college was built in 1808, but its history and tradition go back nearly 400 years to the college that William Cardinal Allen founded at Douai in France in 1568, during the reign of Queen Elizabeth I, founded for the training of English priests for the English mission. The college at Douai was closed during the French Revolution towards the end of the 18th century, and the students and teachers returned here to England and finally settled at Ushaw in 1808. At that time, there were only 30 students. Today, there are 400, drawn from all the northern counties. In her long history, Ushaw has given to the church many great men. She numbers 6 cardinals among her old students. Cardinal Mary Del Valle, Secretary of State to Pope Pius X, was once a student at Ushaw. So was Cardinal Della Fuente, one time Archbishop of Seville. Of the 7 cardinals who have ruled the Archdiocese of Westminster since 1850, no less than 4 have been former students of Ushaw: Cardinal Wiseman, Cardinal Vaughan, Cardinal Hinsley, and Cardinal Godfrey. Cardinal Godfrey, the present Archbishop of Westminster, was also a member of the teaching staff here for several years. There are many other archbishops and bishops who once knelt in this chapel as students, among them Archbishop Heenan of Liverpool, well known to so many viewers, and also Bishop Brunner of Middlesbrough, who celebrated a few months ago the first nuptial mass to be televised in England. We see now at the back the president of the college, Monsignor Paul Grant. Ushaw is proud of the cardinals and archbishops and bishops she has trained. She is proud, too, of the great host of priests who work among the people in the parishes throughout the northern counties. Whenever you see a Catholic priest in this part of the country, the probability is that he was trained here at Ushaw. Nearly all the boys and young men in the chapel this morning hope one day to be priests. Nearly all, but not quite all, for Ushaw has always provided education for lay students, as they are called, as well as for church students. And she values very highly a tradition which enables laity and clergy to be educated together in the closest possible companionship. But whatever their future life walks in life, for all of them, this chapel plays an essential part in their college life. Now, and through the years to come, this is their spiritual home. The celebrant, Father Philip Loftus, who lectures in moral theology and canon law at the college, is a celebrant this morning. The deacon and subdeacon are senior students, due to be ordained to the priesthood in a few months' time. You'll notice that the college chapel differs from the ordinary parish church in having its benches facing inwards instead of towards the altar. Its style is that of the old monastic choir. With an interior length of 159 feet and a height of 56 feet, it is one of the biggest churches of this style in England. Is under the direction of Father Lawrence Hollis and has appeared on television before and has also broadcast several times in recent years. It is a choir of about 70 voices. But much of the singing this morning will be done by a whole body of students. The choir as such, confining itself to the Kyrie, the Gloria, the Sanctus, Benedictus, and Agnus Dei. Sacrifice of the Mass begins. The priest sprinkles all present with holy water. This is a reminder to us that we must purify ourselves for this great act of worship. Meanwhile, everybody sings part of Psalm 50. Have mercy on me, O God, as thou art ever rich in mercy. Thou shalt sprinkle me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Washed by thee, I shall be whiter than snow.
Ascende nobis Domine misericordiam tuam.
Et laudate Domini.
Domine exaudi orationem meam.
Et laudate Domini.
Dominus vobiscum.
Et uncere nobis.
Father, eternal God, and graciously send thy holy angel from heaven to watch over and cherish, protect and defend and care for all who make this place their home. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Omnes habitantes in hoc habitaculum, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Dominus, Deo Vos.
You shall call upon me, and I shall hear you. This is the message of the entrance psalm of today's Mass, the last Sunday after Pentecost. The Lord says, I think thoughts of peace and not of affliction. You shall call upon me, and I shall hear you. Of the cross. I will go up to the altar of God, the altar of God at which we are to offer this sacrifice of the Mass. Confesses to God Almighty, to the Virgin Mary, the sinless one, to St. Michael, the Archangel, who overthrew Satan, to St. John the Baptist, who preached repentance, to the holy apostles Peter and Paul, and to the whole court of heaven. Greek words which mean, Lord have mercy on us, Christ have mercy on us. Thank you. Sings the hymn of the angels on the first Christmas night. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of goodwill. As God's creatures, we praise him, we bless him, we adore him, we glorify him, we thank him. The priest welcomes us all with the ancient Christian greeting, "The Lord be with you." And now he prays, "Lord, we beg thee, stir the wills of thy faithful to seek more eagerly the fruits of thy divine work, and to find in their loving kindness more abundant healing through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Pieta his way, remedia maiora percipiant. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
The subdeacon now sings the epistle, which is from St. Paul's epistle to the Colossians. In it, St. Paul emphasizes the essential points in a true Christian's life. We must have a real faith with practical charity. We must have gratitude to God for all things, our life, our health, our homes, our families. But above all, we must thank God for our redemption through the blood of Christ.
In omni vitu te comportati, secundum potentiam claricatis eius, in omni patientia et longanimitate cum gaudio, gratias agentes Deo Patri, qui dignus nos fecit in patem sortis sanctorum in lumine, qui erituit noste potestate tenebrarum, et transtulit in regnum filii dilecti omnis suae, in quo habemus redemptionem per sanguinem eius, remissionem peccatorum.
Preparations are made for the singing of the Gospel by the deacon. For the Gospel is the climax of the first part, the preparatory part of the Mass. The book of the Gospels is placed upon the altar so that Christ's words may come to us from the very place at which his sacrifice is to be offered. The entrance psalm for today's Mass gave us a message of trust in God. You shall call upon me, and I shall hear you. And now the gradual psalm reminds us how often the Lord has heard us. Thou hast delivered us, O Lord, from them that afflict us. The procession moves into place for the singing of the gospel. The candles are borne by the acolytes to remind us that the gospel is the light of the world.
Dominus vobiscum. Sancti Evangelii secundum Matteum.
Gloria tibi,
In illo tempore dixit Iesus discipulis suis, cum videritis abominationem desolationis, quae dicta est a Daniele propheta, stantem in loco sancto, qui legit intelligat. Tunc qui in Judea sunt, fugiant ad montes, et qui in tecto non descendat tollere aliquid de domo sua, et qui in agro non revertatu tollere tunicam suam. Veat impregnantibus et nutrientibus in illis diebus. Ora te autem, ut non fiat fuga vestra, in hio me vel sabbato. Erit enim tum tribulatio mania, qualis non fuit ab initio mundi, usque modo neque fiet. Et nisi breviati fuisent dies illi, non fierent salva omnis caro, sed propter electos breviabuntur dies illi.
The Gospel is from St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24. Our Lord speaks to his disciples of the destruction of the holy city of Jerusalem, as foretold by Daniel the prophet. There is a warning for us too, that we have not here a lasting city. One day, a greater and more terrible desolation than that foretold by Daniel will come upon this world of ours. And in the words of our Lord himself, immediately after the distress of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will refuse her light, and the stars will fall from heaven, and the powers of heaven will rock, and then the sign of the Son of Man will be seen in the heaven. Then it is that all the tribes of the land will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming upon the clouds of heaven with great power and glory. And he will send out his angels with a loud blast of the trumpet to gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. The fig tree will teach you a parable. When its branches grow supple and begin to put out leaves, you know that summer is near. So you, when you see all this come about, ought to know that it is here at your very doors. Believe me, this generation will not have passed before all this is accomplished. Though heaven and earth should pass away, my word will stand.
Et tunc parebit signum filii hominis in caelo, et tunc plangent omnes tribus terrae. Et videbunt filium hominis venientem in nubibus caeli, cum virtute multa et maiestate. Et mittet angelos suos cum tuba, et voce mania, et congregabunt electos eius a quatuo ventis, assumis celorum usque ad terminos eorum. Ab obere autem fici dicite parabolam, cum iam ramus eius tener fuerit, et folia nata, citis quia propeest estas, ita et vos, cum videritis haec omnia, citote quia propeest in januis. Amen dico vobis, quia non praeteribit generatio haec, donec omnia haec fiant. Caelum et terra transibunt, verba autem mea non praeteribunt.
The priest kisses the book of the Gospels and says, through the Gospel words may our sins be wiped away. in response to the word of God, proclaimed in the gospel and expounded in the sermon. We make together an act of faith. You can join us in it. We proclaim our belief in the one God, in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who was born of the Virgin Mary and suffered and died for us, who will come again, as the gospel has reminded us, to judge all mankind. We believe in the Holy Ghost, in the Church founded by Christ, in one baptism, in forgiveness of sins, and in eternal life. Wine that ought to be changed into the body and blood of Christ. wine is poured into the chalice. And to this is added a drop of water. That drop of water symbolizes our offering in this great sacrifice of the Mass. Incensed out of reverence, and for the same reason the altar is incensed. Meanwhile the students sing Psalm 129. Out of the depths I have cried to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. This is the psalm used by the church in her prayers for the dead. Prayers that are said with special fervor during this month of November, the month of the Holy Service. We pray for all the dead, for our own dead, for those who have nobody to pray for those who are already forgotten by their friends and relatives. Especially vivid in the thoughts of these students this morning must be that young fellow student of theirs who died so suddenly at the beginning of this term. Eternal rest give unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest. Back to the deacon and says, may the Lord kindle within us the fire of his love and the flame of his everlasting charity. It is this message that the deacon now carries to the congregation. May the Lord kindle within us the fire of his love and the flame of his everlasting charity. First of the congregation to be anointed and to be incensed is Monsignor Paul Grant, president of this college. After him, each priest in turn, and then, finally, all the congregation. All receive that message. May the Lord kindle within us the fire of his love and the flame of everlasting charity. Thank you.
Domino Deo nostro.
To the act of sacrifice, we are exhorted to lift up our hearts and give thanks to the Lord, the Father Almighty, to the only begotten Son, and to the Holy Ghost. After giving thanks to the everlasting Trinity, we pray that we too may always join in the heavenly praise of the whole court of heaven, saying forever, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts. Enter the heart of the Mass, the canon of the Mass, in which we pray the identical prayer that St. Augustine prayed when he said Mass for the first time in Canterbury nearly 1400 years ago. The priest prays for the whole Church, and especially for those who are present at this Mass. Briefly, he pauses to pray for all those who have asked his prayers. We too can do just that. Pray for our families, our friends, the people we work with, the sick people who live in our street. To us the great moment of the consecration is approaching. The priest spreads his hands over the chalice and host, earnestly invoking God. God's blessing on this offering he is about to make. The priest takes into his hands the sacred host and recalls and does just what Christ did at the Last Supper, who the day before he suffered took bread into his holy hands and, giving thanks, gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body." We adore, praise and acknowledge Christ now present on the altar. In like manner, after he had supped, taking the chalice into his holy hands, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink ye all of this, for this is the chalice of my blood, of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith." In the chalice that you see raised up is the very blood of Christ. Entry into Jerusalem on the first Palm Sunday. "Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Moment, the priest pauses to remember the dead, especially his own dead. Perhaps at this moment you too have someone you can pray for.
Seculorum.
Amen.
Oremus preceptis salutaribus moniti et divina institutione formati.
The priest invites us all to say with him the very prayer taught to us by Christ himself. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen.
Quod et mos dimittimus et debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem.
Taking in his hands a sacred host, the priest breaks it over the chalice. Our Lord broke the bread at the Last Supper, and it was in the breaking of bread that the disciples on the road to Emmaus recognized our Lord. St. John the Baptist, we call on our Lord as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world. We ask him to have mercy on us and give us peace. Peace of mind, peace of heart, a true and lasting peace. The choir puts into song this prayer of ours. Taking part in the Mass, may it be at peace with one another. The kiss of peace is passed from one to another with the greeting, "Peace be to you," an ancient Christian greeting dating back to apostolic times. Before he actually receives Holy Communion, the priest acknowledges his unworthiness, saying three times, "Lord, I am not worthy." At this particular Mass, the priest is the only one to receive Holy Communion. That is because everybody else in the chapel has already received Holy Communion at an earlier Mass. Every morning of the week, at 7:15, the whole college gathers in this chapel for the community Mass. On Sundays and major feast days, they gather again at a later hour for a more solemn celebration of the liturgy. Mindful of the message of the entrance song, "You shall call upon me and I shall hear you," all sing the communion antiphon, which is our Lord's promise of help as recorded by St. Mark in his Gospel. Be assured, when you ask anything in prayer, you have only to believe it. In the end, it will be yours.
vobis, et quid fedorant et fetitis credite quia accipietis et fiat vobis.
Dominum vobis cum,
et cum meum
oremus concede nobis.
The priest now invites us all to say with him this prayer: grant us, we beseech thee, Lord, that whatever there is of evil in our hearts may be cured by the healing power of the sacrament we have received through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominus vobiscum,
et cum deum tuum.
The Mass is nearly over, and the deacon pronounces the dismissal. For the last time, the priest kisses the altar and then turns and blesses the congregation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Mass is concluded with the sublime words of sacred scripture from the first chapter of St. John's Gospel. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, he gave them power to be made the sons of God, to them that believe in his name. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, the glory as it were of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The last prayer of all is for Her Majesty the Queen. Almighty God, we pray thee for thy servant Elizabeth our Queen, now by thy mercy reigning over us. Adorn her yet more with every virtue. Remove all evil from her path, that with her consort and all the royal family, she may come at last in grace to thee, who art the way, the truth, and the life, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Te qui via veritas et vita est, cum consorte et prole regia, gratiosas valiat perveniere, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Today, one often hears criticisms of modern youth, of its selfishness and irresponsibility. Before we leave you, then, just look again at these young men and boys, 400 of them in all. There can't be much wrong with the younger generation of today if we can still produce people like these, people who are willing to undergo long years of training and discipline and to give up so many of the ordinary pleasures of youth in response to the call of Christ to forsake all and follow him. There is really nothing very exceptional about these young men and boys. They are just ordinary lads, something like the boy next door. Perhaps one of them is the boy next door. Anyway, all of them need and ask your prayers that they will please God. Persevere in their ideals and their vocation. May God bless them all and those who train and teach them. And may God bless their parents and the homes that reared such sons.
1971, Gloria Hunniford introduces our second preview of the songs competing in this year's Eurovision Song Contest.
And continuing the series tomorrow night, Island of Outcasts uncovers the degrading and inhuman conditions under which mental patients on the Greek island of Leros exist. Major new documentaries with a cutting edge, Mondays at 9 on 4.
This is Channel 4. Now, a programme first seen in dispatches late last year. The remarkable events, which began with the sudden political activism of the Prague students, captured on film...